Hello and welcome to Urban Green, where we spotlight South Sound environmental efforts and showcase different ways to get involved in sustainable living practices. I'm your host, Stacey Ellifrit, and today we're coming to you from the Tacoma Nature Center. In this winter edition, we're starting with an urban learning segment that brings us to the Theophos Waterway. It's here we take a closer look at a project that will offer additional capacity to the city's stormwater system in the downtown Tacoma area.
A project is getting underway that will install over 2,700 feet of 60-inch stormwater pipe and build a new outfall into the Theophos Waterway. The Jefferson Avenue and Hood Street Surface Water Interceptor Project is getting underway in the downtown Tacoma area.
An interceptor is a large diameter pipeline that collects flows from smaller pipes. An interceptor receives all those collective flows, which means they end up being the larger pipes in our stormwater system.
The main purpose of a stormwater system is to drain standing water, like rain or snowmelt, from city streets. That stormwater is transported to an outfall that will then empty into a local waterway.
The benefits of this project are creation of jobs for locals under the City of Tacoma Equity and Contracting Programs, a reduction in traffic disruption caused by flooding, as well as reduction in property damage also caused by flooding, and an improvement to our stormwater capacity system and allows for future growth.
Construction started in October of this year and is expected to be completed in the fall of 2022. The alignment begins at South 19th Street and Court D, and will end at Dock Street with the new outfall. An important aspect for the community to know is what can be expected during construction.
The public may experience parking and delivery restrictions, pedestrian and vehicle detours, and closures if necessary.
Most stormwater pipes will be installed using open-cut construction. The complexity of this project is unique in that there are also three different locations where crews will utilize micro-tunneling.
One is we're tunneling underneath Pacific Avenue under the light link rail, and the other is we're crossing the set of BNSF railroad tracks as well as tunneling down Dock Street. In order to microtunnel underneath streets, you have a receiving pit and a launching pit and launch the machine to go underneath the streets.
This is also a progressive design build project, which can yield several advantages.
And it is to have a single point of contact with the city during the design phase and the construction phase, and the ability for the city to work closely with the design builder during the progression of the design, as well as increases the innovation by having the contractor and the design builder on the same team. It allows for us to better manage our construction-related risks.
The city was very selective in assembling the design build team for this project.
Due to the need to cross a number of significant transportation corridors, the extensive list of required permits, and the sensitive location within our downtown business core, the team consists of Pacific Northwest firms Kennedy Jenks and James Fowler, collectively with the city.
This project is an important part of the underground network of stormwater pipes in and around the downtown area that will enable the city to improve existing stormwater system capacity.
To find out more about the Jefferson Avenue and Hood Street Surface Water Interceptor Project, visit the city site. Up next, the Urban Tabletop segment will take us to Comadre Kombucha. It's here owner Julie Davidson will deliver a mixology demonstration using kombucha and other fresh ingredients.
I'm Julie Davidson, owner and operator of Comadre Kombucha Tap Room. Kombucha is a fermented tea that contains prebiotic and probiotic cultures. It's fermented by two factors. One is the introduction of a symbiotic culture of bacteria and yeast, and two is how it feeds. Kombucha is created when sweet tea meets that culture. The culture needs sugar and tannins in order to keep growing. And what the culture does while it's nibbling on the sugars and the tea is that it creates this lovely fermentation and gives all of us all of the beneficial bacteria that help our gut, that help with all kinds of other health conditions. There are several health benefits associated with regular consumption of kombucha tea. The biggest one, of course, is that it helps to regulate the functioning of your gut. Now, I'm not a physician, and I don't pretend to be selling some kind of magic elixir here. In my own experience, however, I know that kombucha has helped me to overcome a lot of digestive health issues that probably would have required pharmaceuticals had I not started to eat healthier and include kombucha as part of my daily diet. Comadre Kombucha really has been a lifelong dream of mine. When I was growing up, I always played store, and I took great inspiration from the entrepreneurial family members who were always sharing stories about businesses they were launching in Panama. And later on, as I grew up and started to connect with the Cuban side of my family, I realized I come from an industrious people. So I've always been out ahead, sort of coming up with the next big thing. And when the COVID pandemic hit, all of the contracts that I had built up over many, many years started disappearing before my very eyes. And I had been brewing kombucha as a hobby for years and thought, you know, now might be a moment to put some feelers out. So I started the Booch Brigade, which was a door delivery service to bring kombucha to my friends, colleagues, and family members. And unbeknownst to me, that process of sharing kombucha just to help boost everyone's spirits and boost their health actually became a wonderful case study for me to test the concept and see if my product was viable. And it was. So I started looking for real estate, and just about a year ago, I found this place on 6th Avenue and have been here in operation since the middle of May, really enjoying the neighborhood and all of our wonderful, you know, supportive businesses along the Ave. Folks who are interested in trying Comadre Kombucha are welcome to visit us at our 6th Avenue tap room. In addition, if you visit the website, and that's comadrekombucha.com, you can find an interactive map that will show you the 10 plus places where kombucha is being served on tap or in bottles. Folks have been really supportive and really wanting to support a local kombucha provider. So we're excited to see that expand and to see Comadre Kombucha in other places throughout Pierce County. Kombucha tea makes a great mixer for all kinds of drinks. And at Comadre Kombucha Tap Room, we actually replace alcohol with the kombucha tea that we brew. So I'd love to show you our homage to a Cuban classic, the mojito. Here at Comadre, we call it La Mojita. We're gonna start with unflavored kombucha and add to that the classic flavors of the mojito, mint and lime. This mint is locally harvested in Puyallup. So I like to start with mint and lime at the bottom of my cup and get my muddler and blend those together. It helps release the essences so you have a really flavorful drink. Once that's muddled, I add some ice. And you can do this at home with mint and lime and whatever kombucha you like. But here at Comadre, we use an unflavored kombucha. And because I really like that mint and lime, I also have a favorite simple syrup with just a little kick. Once that's in, I top it off with just a little more mint and add some garnish. And it's ready to enjoy. Salud.
To find out more about Comadre Kombucha and their products that are locally made with care, visit their website. After the break, we learn more about the Washington Materials Marketplace. But first, the Urban Quick Tip will demonstrate how to make a natural all-purpose cleaner. Welcome back. Next up, we learn about the Washington Materials Marketplace. This free online platform aims to create a network where hard-to-recycle items become another organization's raw materials.
The Washington Materials Marketplace is a free online platform for businesses and organizations to list and request different materials. These items can consist of excess building, shipping, or packaging materials, as well as equipment.
The Washington Materials Marketplace is funded through a grant from the Washington Department of Ecology, and we established the platform at the City of Tacoma in partnership with the U.S. Business Council for Sustainable Development and the Seattle Good Business Network.
This pilot program aims to create a closed-loop, collaborative network where hard-to-recycle waste and byproducts become another organization's raw materials.
A circular economy is just that. Instead of linear, it's circular, and it's really focused on waste prevention, reuse, and recycling. So instead of extracting material, materials are taken as a recycled feedstock for a manufacturer, and then they're put back into the economy as many times as they can, and keeping value added to the materials themselves.
Joining the materials marketplace is easy. Those who are interested can start by requesting an invitation online and setting up an account. Or a 15-minute complimentary meeting can be scheduled with city staff to walk through the process.
We've had all kinds of businesses join to date. We've had second-use building materials, where we are today as a member. We've had architectural firms, construction firms, demolition companies. We've had a lot of artists. We've had other small businesses that are looking to maybe find everything from office supplies to furniture. So there's really no limit to who can join.
The platform is straightforward. After a user sets up an account, they can include information on the types of materials they are trying to get rid of or the types of materials they are seeking.
For example, let's say a company has pallets that they're trying to get rid of. They would go ahead and fill out a profile for that particular material and let folks know if it's available one time, if it's a regularly occurring material that's available, give information on the weight or the volume, whether it can be picked up or not, whether there's a cost involved, that type of thing.
The program started this past summer through a grant from the Department of Ecology. The city has committed for the next year, and the grant has covered the cost for user fees so that it's a free platform.
The State Department of Commerce and Department of Ecology are very interested in the pilot that we're doing here in Tacoma and kind of the King County, Pierce County area. And so we're already talking to state agencies about taking it over and making it a permanent statewide platform.
To find out more about this platform and how to register your organization for an account, visit the city site. Up next is the Urban How-To. This do-it-yourself segment offers an introduction to dehydrated meal planning.
Today, we're going to be looking at how easy it is to put together shelf-stable emergency meals with dehydrated food, that the majority of it is dehydration that you've done yourself. So let's start, like the day starts with a good breakfast. So certainly there'll be other things that will go with this, but the basis for a good breakfast is something that's rich in carbohydrates and additional protein and minerals. And so we're going to go and start, and everything's been pre-measured. There are links in the comments section so that you can go and see the full recipes, because there's like 20 variations of other ingredients you can put in here. But the basic start is with rolled oats, a high quality powdered milk, then we mixed it together, brown sugar and cinnamon. You can also use any kind of other sweetener like xylitol. You don't want to use anything that has liquids in it though. You don't want to use honey unless you have mixed your oats with it and dehydrate the honey into the oats. And then oat bran and chia seeds mixed together. So that kicks up the proteins. And I like to go ahead and just mix it together. I really got too big a container for this demonstration, but this is one average serving. The recipe on the site says how you can double it or triple it. And so then these are some plum pieces from plums that I dehydrated. And I usually like to leave the sweetener and the fruit out until I've tasted it. But then I also like my fruit to be chewy. If you do it that way, it's going to be chewy as opposed to have softened up. And basically, if you're out camping, you soak the whole thing for about 2 minutes. You cook it for about 2 minutes, and then you let it soak a little bit longer for another minute or two, and it's ready to go. The second meal of the day is going to be a vegetable bean noodle soup. So we're starting with just ramen noodles, and there's nothing wrong with the noodles themselves. It's the little flavoring packets that you buy with them that have a lot of chemical additives. So you don't use those. And then this is a basis for all vegetable bean soups. It's carrots, garbanzo beans, black beans, leeks, and onions that I've dehydrated myself. Oh, and some green peas. And a little extra onion. Red peppers that I've dehydrated. And then sun-dried tomato slices. And basically everything in here are things that I dehydrated myself. And so you see it's a nice colorful mixture. This one, once again, there's a step-by-step procedure where you soak it in warm water for a few minutes, then you cook it for a few minutes, and then you let it sit for like 5 minutes. And you may need to reheat it after that. But all those instructions are in the link. Now, to flavor this, you have choices. You can use small bouillon cubes, but those usually have a lot of salt in them. Or you can get some powdered bouillon without extra sodium. Or you can get vegetable bouillon and use that. Then the last one is a special one where I get to show off a couple of things. It's macaroni and cheese with meat and in a tangy cheese sauce. So we start off with macaroni. It's just the same kind. You want smaller pieces of macaroni so that it cooks up evenly with everything else. So you soak that first for a little bit. It's all in the instructions. And then you go ahead and add, this is freeze-dried sausage bits. Now, as I've mentioned in other videos and at other times, dairy and meat and cheese are all things that it's really difficult to dehydrate at home safely. So it's worth it to buy those. So we assume that's already been soaked. We throw in the meat. We throw in some more onions, then dehydrated mushrooms. And then this is one of my favorite things. In fact, this morning I just made some more of. You've heard of fruit leathers. You can also make vegetable leathers for flavoring. This is a tomato leather. It's pureed tomatoes, and it's very crispy. And you put quite a bit of it in. But then that will dissolve and make a tomato sauce. Now, once this is mostly cooked, you have powdered milk and a cheddar cheese powder. And those would go in. And without the liquid, it's not going to look quite as nice. But when I take this home tonight and cook it, I've never done this before with them out of order, so I'll let you know somewhere. I'll put it in the comments section eventually and let you know how it comes out. And then the last thing to mention is it's always good. I try to leave the salt and pepper up to the individuals. So have small containers. You can even, if you can get a hold of them, like in the restaurants, which they're using back again a lot, individual salt and pepper, but you want to seal them up in a bag or even vacuum pack them. And then, of course, trail mix, snack mixes. So one of the things that I like to have with me or have on hand are dates, unsulfured, partially dehydrated dates. And these could be sealed in a vacuum pack also. They're very high in minerals. They're also really high in carbohydrates. But then, of course, there's trail mixes. And one of our links takes you to, I think it's 7 different trail mixes, which are very unusual ones. Like this one, they call a wasabi mix, which has wasabi peas, but it also has your cashews, sunflower seeds, but low sugar cranberries to add that tartness as well as the spiciness. And then of course you can also get some dark chocolate bars, and I make sure that they're in a baggie or vacuum packed because heat may get to them. And other dried fruits like apples, pears, things like that.
These how-tos were created in partnership with the EnviroHouse Free Workshop Series, designed to support healthy, sustainable homes and gardens. For a full listing of online workshops, check out the city site. Urban Green will be back again in 2022 with an updated look and a new host. Thank you for joining me for this edition and all other editions I hosted for the past 5 years. I'm Stacey Ellifrit, leaving you one more time with more ways to safely engage in sustainable practices that are right for your lifestyle.